bite.
Yeah.
the church.
We got a guest speaker coming
on the 12th. Her name is Gaylene Tuttle, or Tootle, whatever she says, but she's going back to Ukraine again. She's brought, been there twice now. Well, she lived there when she was a kid, but we're gathering suitcases, duffel bags, any kind of bag, backpack, for her to take medical supplies over. And the coffee hour is going for Ukraine.
And that's in 2 weeks.
Two weeks.
Other announcements this morning? I believe there are some meatball supper signups back there, if you're interested. That comes up in something like 4 weeks. I think it's the 18th, March. Let's rise and worship God together. Holy Trinity, one God, who journeys with us these 40 days and sustains us with the gift of grace.
Amen.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus, walk with us this day. Walk with us these 40 days of Lent. Walk with us together as one people. Walk with us towards the cross and towards new life. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Let us acknowledge before God and one another our need for repentance and God's mercy. Holy God, we confess
to you our faults and failings. Too often we neglect and do not trust your holy word. We take for ourselves instead of giving to others. We spoil rather than steward your creation. We cause hurt through the thoughts of you. We choose fear over compassion. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us as we seek to follow in your way of life. Amen.
People of God, hear the good news. God so loved the world that God gave the only Son so that all may receive new life. This is the promise for you. God embraces you with divine mercy, forgives you in Christ's name, and revives you in the Spirit's power.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be and abide with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Lord
God,
our
strength, the struggle between good and evil, rages within and around us. And the devil and all forces that defy you tempt us with empty promises. Keep us steadfast in your word, and when we fall, raise us again, and restore us through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Please be seated as we hear the word.
Good morning.
Good morning.
The first reading is from Genesis chapter 2, verses 15 through 17, and chapter 3, verses 1 through 7. Human beings were formed with great care to be in relationship with the Creator, creation, and one another. The serpent's promise to the first couple that their eyes would be opened led, ironically, to the discovery only that they were naked. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to till it and keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, "You may freely eat of every tree of the garden, but of the tree of knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat of it you shall die." Now the serpent was more crafty than any other wild animal that the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God say you shall not eat from any tree in the garden?" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat of the fruit of the trees in the garden, but God said, you shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that is in the middle of the garden, nor shall you touch it, or you shall die." But the serpent said to the woman, "You will not die, for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. And she also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made loincloths for themselves. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We'll read Psalm 32 responsively by all first. Happy are they whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sin is put away.
Happy are they to whom the Lord imputes no guilt, and in the spirit there is no guile.
While I held my tongue, my bones withered away because of my groaning all day long.
For your hand was heavy upon me day and night. My moisture was dried up as in the heat of summer.
Then I acknowledged my sin to you and did not conceal my guilt. I said, "I will confess my transgressions to the Lord." Then you forgave me the guilt of my sin.
Therefore, all the faithful will make their prayers to you in time of trouble. When the great waters overflow, they shall not reach them.
You are my hiding place. You preserve me from trouble. You surround me with shouts of deliverance.
I will instruct you and teach you in the way that you should go. I will guide you with my eye.
Do not be like the horse or mule, which have no understanding, who must be fitted with bit and bridle, or else they will not stay near you.
Great are the tribulations of the wicked, but mercy embraces those who trust in the Lord.
Be glad, you righteous, and rejoice in the Lord. Shout for joy, all who are true of heart. The second reading is from Romans chapter 5, verses 12 through 19. Through Adam's disobedience, humanity came under bondage to sin and death, from which we cannot free ourselves. In Christ's obedience to death, God graciously showers on us the free gift of liberation and life. Just as sin came into the world through one man, and death came through sin, and so death spread to all because all have sinned, sin was indeed in the world before the law. But sin is not reckoned when there is no law. Yet death exercised dominion from Adam to Moses, even over those whose sins were not like the transgression of Adam, who is a type of the one who was to come. But the free gift is not like the trespass. For if many die through the one man's trespass, many more surely have the grace of God, and the free gift and the grace of the one man, Jesus Christ, abounded for many. And the free gift is not like the effect of the one man's sin. For the judgment following one trespass brought salvation. But the free gift of following many trespasses brings justification. If because of the one man's trespass, death exercised dominion through that one, much more surely will those who receive the abundance of grace and the free gift of righteousness exercise dominion in life through the one man, Jesus Christ. Therefore, just as one man's trespass led to condemnation for all, so one man's act of righteousness leads to justification and life for all. For just as by the one man's disobedience, the many were made sinners, so by the one man's obedience, the many will be made righteous. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. He fasted 40 days and 40 nights, and afterwards he was famished. Then the tempter came and said to him, "Well, if you are the Son of God, command these stones become loaves of bread." But Jesus answered, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple mount, saying to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will never dash your foot against the stone." Jesus said in reply, "Again it is written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and all of their splendor. And he said to him, "All these I will give you if you will just fall down and worship me." Jesus said, "Away with you, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him." Then the devil left him, and suddenly angels came and waited on him. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Today, we are going to do a whole sermon on one sentence. Now, I didn't say in one sentence, so we'll spend on one sentence. So let's begin right where we just begun with the first verse, the first sentence in chapter 4 of Matthew's Gospel. Then, Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness. Now, Jesus going into the wilderness. I found that in Minnesota, when we start talking about the wilderness, we get kind of excited. Like, Jesus getting to go spend some time in the wilderness, great. I'll get to do some fishing and hunting, some camping and hiking, maybe. Maybe there's even a hockey team and croquet involved, I don't know. That sounds fun, doesn't it? Well, the wilderness in Jesus' land wasn't lush forests. It wasn't filled with things to eat and water to drink. It wasn't exactly filled with fun either. The wilderness was a place in between. It was a place of emptiness and thirst.
Where else does that come up in Scripture? There's at least a few, so what do you think? Where else does the number 40 come up in Scripture?
Exodus.
Exodus, yeah, yeah. So where would that have been? What kind of story? Yeah.
The 40 years in the wilderness,
yeah,
between they went to Jordan.
40 years in the wilderness.
Yeah.
Yeah. The Israelites, after leaving Egypt, spent not just 40 days, but 40 years in the wilderness. That's a really, really big one for this one. There's like at least a couple more that I can think of. Where else can you think of the number 40 that comes up? Noah's Ark! Yes! Noah was on the ark with all those animals and his family for 40 days. That's a different kind of wilderness, isn't it? There's at least one more that I can think of. It also comes in Exodus. It has something to do with what we read last week. Do you have any thoughts?
Burning bush?
Burning bush? Close is the right person. So Moses, after seeing the burning bush, led the people of Israel out of Egypt and then straight up a mountain. And then he stayed there for 40 days. For 40 days.
Oh, yeah.
While he received the law. That's a whole other kind of wilderness. A wilderness separated from the people and dwelling with the presence of God. So what does this have to do with Jesus? And what do these things have in common? This number 40. That's kind of a theme of this gospel so far, isn't it? The numbers that mean more when they appear on the surface. Well, this number 40 is important not just because of where they are in a kind of wilderness place, but also it's important because of what happened to them while they were there for 40 days or 40 years. And what was happening to them is that in each case, in the case of Moses on the mountain, and Noah and his family on the ark, and the whole people of Israel in the desert, they were all being shaped and formed by God for what was to come next. And it's the same with Jesus. He was in the wilderness for 40 days. And remember, this is all the way back in chapter 4, and it comes just right after his baptism. That almost has a little bit to do with how we see baptism, doesn't it? Like, we baptize babies, and then for at least 40 days during their childhood, we ask God to help them be shaped by the church, be shaped by their faith. And then sometime in high school, we confirm them and we say that you're saying yes to their baptism. And we'll get to do that with at least one student in a few months. So Jesus, for 40 days, was shaped in the wilderness. Okay, end of sentence. Right? Let me just do a quick check, make sure there's nothing else here. We got to the wilderness, we got to 40 days. Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. Ah, that daggum devil. Always messing things up. We were about to be done, weren't we? To be tempted by the devil. The devil's not really our favorite topic in the West, is he? We have these images in our head of this little red guy with a horn. some kind of intellectual thing to make fun of. The devil and the forces of evil are very real. And I think, sometimes I wonder if we are doing a disservice to ourselves, to our society, when we ignore or try to explain away the force of evil that has, the force that evil has over us. But we're not really here for an intellectual discussion whether the devil is the force behind evil or whether it's simply evil itself in us. It is absolutely true and all too obvious that evil is all too real in our world. And the forces aligned with evil, even without speaking the word devil or evil, are so obvious to us. Sin, death, brokenness, these forces, these things that plague us no matter how hard we try to resist them, these things are all around us. And maybe you caught it. There's another word for the devil in this passage. And I forgot, I was going to give you a challenge to see if you could hear it. There's actually two other names for the devil just in this passage. There's, at the beginning, the devil, Diablo, excuse me. Then, as the devil comes to Jesus, he gets a new name. The devil is called the trickster, or the tempter, or maybe even the accuser. And that name tells us or reminds us that evil does something particularly cruel to us. The trickster or the tempter takes something that is good, something like the words of Scripture or good intentions, and then twists it into something bad, into something that harms self or neighbor. And this kind of twisting, it's a dangerous kind of thing. So, let's go back to our sentence. Our sentence begins, Jesus was led up by the Spirit. By the Spirit. Now, some of us may wonder, and I myself wondered this when reading this, what kind of Spirit is this? Because the Spirit, it makes total sense to us that the Spirit would lead Jesus into the wilderness. Right? If the wilderness was the place that people were shaped by God, then of course that's where Jesus would be led. But then there's this tricky and obnoxious issue of the devil. And the end of this sentence says that Jesus was led there not just to be shaped, but to be tempted by the devil. It's like this was almost part of the purpose of the Spirit in doing this. And we would identify this Spirit in Matthew, that shows up in other places, with the Holy Spirit, with God's Spirit. So why in the world would God's Spirit send Jesus into the wilderness, into a place of emptiness and desolation? Why would God send Jesus into that place to be confronted by someone so dangerous? Someone that could take something good, something like the words of God spoken at Jesus' baptism, or the power that Jesus seems to be growing into. Someone who could take that good thing and maybe twist it into something bad. Why would God do something so dangerous? It just, think about it in the words of our Lord's Prayer. What do we say close to the end? So why would the Spirit send? I think it's, yes, it's about the first part of that sentence. It's about Jesus being shaped in the wilderness, but it's about more than that, too. Jesus was sent into the wilderness also to confront the devil himself. Jesus had to confront the forces of evil because that's what the rest of his ministry was going to be about. And if Jesus was going to actually fulfill his purpose, if he was going to preach the good news and to heal the sick, to help feed the hungry and gather a community that would become the church, if Jesus was going to do these things, he would have to be 100% in opposition to the forces of evil. There was no running away from it for Jesus. And this is the beginning of his ministry. That's what the rest of his ministry was going to be about. All the way till what we celebrate at the end of Lent, all the way until the forces of evil conspired against him to kill him. So, what does this have to do for us today? Today, actually a few days ago, we began the season of Lent. We begin what we consider 40 days of wilderness time. 40 days of being shaped and molded by God into the people we are meant to be. And I was talking with a few folks at Bible study about what we used to do in Lent. When I was a kid, every Ash Wednesday, the pastor would kind of have a children's sermon and would give us a little piece of paper and say, what would you like to give up for Lent this year? And then I never felt like I had enough time, but I usually wrote down something like, you know, I think I can give up Jell-O. Because I like Jell-O, but I don't really eat it that much anyway. And then, you know, I would proceed to either eat Jell-O or not eat Jell-O. It depends on if I remember. Then maybe later, as I grow up a little bit more, I might give up something that I really liked a little bit more. Maybe a video game or something like that. Or maybe even the one so many of us have done, giving up something like sugar or chocolate. And, you know, as I reflect on Lent this year, giving up something like chocolate, it just seems kind of empty. It seems like something that isn't going to allow us to be empty so that God can fill it. It doesn't seem like I ever really grew closer to God or did something meaningful because I gave up chocolate for a few weeks and then couldn't take not having sugar anymore. And if you're giving up chocolate this year, or if you have grown closer to God because you've given up chocolate, you can come tell me later and tell me this is the worst sermon ever. That's fine. I would actually love to hear if you feel like you have grown closer to God, or it's been meaningful for you to give up something like that. But I want to invite you this year. During this 40 days of wilderness time, don't miss this opportunity. Don't miss this opportunity to maybe do something real. Something that goes a little bit deeper than giving up chocolate or sugar. Don't miss this opportunity to grow in your faith or be shaped by God. And I want to challenge you too. Maybe in years past you have done something like taking on a prayer practice or reading scripture or finding time for silence or worship. I want to challenge you too. This 40 days of Lent, also be about the other thing that Jesus went into the wilderness for. It can also be about confronting the power of evil in our bed. Doing something real can be something like prayer or reading scripture, something that shapes us, something that helps us grow. And it can also be something like what Jesus did in confronting the devil. Now, I don't encourage you to go seeking out the devil and try to have this conversation with the devil. I'd say probably the less we know about the devil, the better. But perhaps, confronting evil might mean confronting loneliness in your community or in your own life. Perhaps it means confronting the forces of distraction that take us away from God and from each other. Perhaps it's confronting the evil of hunger or homelessness in a new way. Maybe if you are giving up chocolate or something like that, maybe use a little bit of that money and give it away to an organization. This time of 40 days has been around almost since the time of Jesus. So don't miss the opportunity. Don't miss it. It only comes around once a year. Let's be God. Waiting to come when that was over. spaghetti's your favorite food. Yeah, you answered that really quickly. Yeah. I have to think about that a little bit. I think my favorite food is chickpeas. They're sometimes called garbanzo beans. They're really good if you like put them in the oven for 15 minutes and roast them, they get really crispy. They're very tasty. It sounds weird. Yeah. Well, yeah. To each your own, right? I just want to tell you that spaghetti and chickpeas, even though you might not like them, they're all a good thing. And Jesus kind of had special training, so he could fast for a long time. Most of us, we don't need to fast for a long time like that. But we can celebrate the gift of food. That's part of why we like to eat together, both at communion and coffee hour. And, you know, the lovely dolls, too, chicken sandwiches, the good are Let's have a prayer together. Let's repeat after me. Dear Jesus.
Dear Jesus.
Thank you for the gift of food.
Thank you for the gift of food.
Help us to celebrate and rejoice.
Help us to celebrate and rejoice.
When we get to eat together.
When we get to eat together.
In Jesus' name we pray.
In Jesus' name we pray.
I invite you to rise as you are able and confess with me our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended to heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Merciful God,
hear our prayer.
God of creation, you create verdant gardens and expansive deserts. Tend to the needs of every living creature, and bless those who work on farms or with livestock, that the world may be nourished by the fruits of their labor. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
God of love, you know our temptations. Sustain all who govern and legislate. Instill in them a sense of your justice and righteousness, that equity and peace would pervade all the regions and nations of our world. Today, we remember and pray for especially our sisters and brothers in Nigeria as they have just gone to the polls. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
God of love, you are a hiding place for all in distress. Draw near to all who are exiles and accompany all refugees and immigrants, especially those children who may be traveling alone. In times of trouble, trauma, or illness, surround all your people with your steadfast love. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Out of love, you offer abundance to all. Bless the ministries of hospitality in this place. Care for those who tend to the needs of others, especially ushers and worship leaders, coffee hour hosts and faith partners, and all who care for one another here. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
God, we lift up our prayers to you, trusting and knowing that you hear us, whether we have spoken our prayers or whether they remain on our hearts. And we trust in your precious name. Amen. I'll invite you to be seated, and I'll invite those who have a baptismal birthday to join me at the front around. In your baptism, Jesus saved you from your sin and death and received you into God's family. You were given new life and the promise that the Holy Spirit would be always with you, to forgive you daily and to help your faith grow. As you have matured in the faith and in understanding of baptism, I ask you, do you believe that through your baptism God has graciously forgiven your sins and welcomed you into God's family? Do you believe in God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit as we confess our faith in our creeds?
I do believe in God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Do you believe that as you remember your baptism day by day, by confessing your sins in Jesus' name and praying for God's direction in your life, God both forgives your sins and gives you strength through the Holy Spirit to be strengthened in your faith, in your witness to God's love, in Jesus Christ?
I do.
Do you intend to continue in this faith in which you have been baptized?
I do, and I ask God's help each day.
People of God, remember your baptism. Let us pray. Gracious God, in your Son Jesus' death and resurrection, you redeemed the world to yourself. In our baptism, you have claimed each of us as your own. Continue to walk with us, together and individually, that our faith might be daily reaffirmed by your grace. Through your Holy Spirit within us, make our lives to be a witness to your love and grace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
May the peace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Share with one another a sign of the peace of Christ.
Oh, you got it.
Please rise as you are able. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood, which is for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Come, for all are welcome and all is now ready.
Mercy upon us, mercy upon us.
Please rise as you are able. Let us pray.
Embodied God, at your table, we have tasted the goodness of Jesus. With the eyes of our hearts open to your promise, empower us to hear the needs of our neighbors and touch the world with your love. Amen.
Receive now this blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and with mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and grant you peace. Amen.